Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today our discussion is about the hepatobiliary cancer that includes liver, gallbladder and bile. First of all, we will review the anatomy of the hepatobiliary system. The liver is connected, is drained by the right and left hepatic artery, by right and left hepatic duct, which form the common hepatic duct. When after the union with the sister duct, it forms the common bile duct that drains into the ampulla of the ureter by joining into the second part of the duodenum by joining the pancreatic duct. You can see in the figure. Now let's see about the liver. Anatomy of the liver: located in the upper right abdomen, it is the largest of the visceral organs, weighed about 3 pounds. It has mainly two lobes, which are separated by the falciform ligament into left and right lobe. Surgeons tend to separate the lobes into 8 segments by their vascularity. For example, caudate lobe is just near to the inferior vena cava. Then on the left side, lobe segment 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. So you can see in this figure and study on your own. Similarly, this is the inferior surface of the liver, which shows the foramen of Winslow. Now, in the liver, the unoxygenated blood enters the liver from portal vein, and oxygenated feeds the liver through the hepatic artery. Network of tubes, which are called the biliary tree, carry bile from the liver. The smaller ducts connect to form the larger ducts, which unite to form the right and left hepatic ducts. And when these unite, they form a common hepatic duct, which unite with the cystic duct to form common bile. Now, how we classify the liver tumors? We classify them into benign and malignant. The benign are cyst hemangioma, focal nodular hyperplasia, adenoma, biliary hematoma. While the malignant hepato is the hepatocellular carcinoma. This may be cholangiocarcinoma, this may be metastatic colorectal carcinoma, or metastatic neuroendocrine cancer, or other metastatic cancer. Let's see about the benign tumor. First, we will see the hemangioma. Hemangioma are the most common benign tumors in the liver. Women are affected more than the men. Mostly the hemangiomas are asymptomatic. If symptomatic, treatment is surgical excision. They rarely rupture. See, this is the hemangioma which has been resected. Then another benign tumors, they are adenoma. They are exclusively in the women of 30 to 50 years of age, and especially where oral contraceptive pills, which is the main risk factor, they become malignant. There is a 10% chances for malignant transformation. They may rupture, and the treatment is surgical excision. You can see in the peripheral area of the liver here, and the adenoma is displayed. The next is the focal nodular hyperplasia. Women of 20 to 50 years are affected. Steroid scar on the CT scan, you can see in the venous and in the arterial phases. You can see here in this one. Kupffer cells on the scan, the treatment is non-surgical. Then the simple cyst, if symptomatic, they may rupture, may cause infection, bleed, or may have a suspicious of a carcinoma. Treatment is surgical excision and roof over seal. Polycystic liver disease is associated with renal failure. Women of 30 to 80 years are mainly affected. 50% patients have polycystic kidneys as well. Now the malignant tumor. Malignant tumors of the liver are defined as hepatocellular carcinoma, which is the number one. The hepatocellular carcinoma is the most common. Men of 40 to 70 years are more affected. The risk factors for the malignant hepatocellular carcinoma in the are the cirrhosis, hepatitis B, C, carcinogens, hemochromatosis, tyrosinemia, the glycogen storage disease, Wilson adenoma, schistosomiasis, alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, and blood group D. Then there may be liver metastasis. The most common tumors are the liver. They are the liver metastasis. Much more frequent than the primary tumors, and they come from the colon, lung, breast, melanoma, carcinoid tumors, renal cell carcinoma. CEA is a reliable indicator for recurrence of the colon carcinoma previously treated. You can see in the CT scan. So these are the different metastatic areas where the carcinoma can spread into the liver. Now the liver cancer, they may be hepatocellular carcinoma, extrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, or intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. The hepatic cell carcinoma is the most common type by far. It occurs in the people who have a history of hepatitis or cirrhosis and associated with the aflatoxin B 3:1 ratio of males to female, while the extrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma is a ratio of 1:1, and intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma is a ratio of 2:1. If we see pathologically, the liver, hepatocellular carcinoma, they are often multifocal, characterized as a high or low grade skip metastasis. 1/3 have a regional lymph node spread, 1/3 have a intra-abdominal mets, and 1/3 have a lung mets. Some people have all three types of metastasis. How the patient presents in the liver carcinoma? Mostly, the patient, they present as a pain, palpable mass, cirrhosis, ascite, and jaundice, although it is a rare. How we diagnose? The diagnosis and workup is, first of all, we will advise the ultrasonography. We can go for the control CT scan. Serum alpha fetoprotein is the serum marker for the hepatocellular carcinoma. Carcinoembryonic antigen, it is a non-specific tumor marker, but it tells us about the colon carcinoma. Then liver function test, we can go far. We can do FNN and open biopsy, history and lab works, angiography, chest x-ray for lung metastasis. So this is the outcome. So these are the figures. You can start like this. This is the hepatocellular carcinoma, small cell carcinoma, peripheral cholangiocarcinoma. See, these are the metastatic carcinomas. Also, you can see here. You can see here in the cirrhosis. Now, how can we prevent? Since cure is unlikely, prevention is and screening are keys to survival. Hepatitis B vaccination is useful, and we can test for the alpha fetoproteins. Treatment options are hepatic resection, liver transplantation, ablation techniques, radiofrequency ablation, ethanol ablation, cryoablation, microwave ablation. So then regional liver therapies like chemoembolization, hepatic artery pump chemoperfusion, internal radiation therapy, external beam radiation therapy, intensity modulated radiation therapy, systemic chemotherapy, and multimodality approach. Only surgery is potentially curative for hepatocellular carcinoma, but 25% patients are only the technical candidates. Cirrhosis rules out many patients, and location in the portal hepatitis as well, area of the portal vein and hepatic artery with high PDT, multi-global presentations also rules out surgery. These are contraindications. Then chemo, often done with the direct infusion, radiation therapy, we can go for that. As the metastatic carcinoma to the liver, for example, from the colorectum are concerned, over 50% of the patients diagnosed with colorectal carcinoma will develop hepatic metastasis. during their lifetime. The traditional teaching suggests that hepatic resection for metastatic colorectal carcinoma of the liver, if technically feasible, should be. However, the recent studies have challenged this paradigm. In a series of 235 patients who underwent hepatic resection for metastatic colorectal carcinoma, the 10-year survival rate of patients with 4 or more nodules was 29%. So, nearly comparable to the 32% survival rate of patients with only a solitary tumor metastasis. 32% and 29%. So, this is a scheme of the hepatocellular carcinoma, how we are going to proceed with this. Now, on the cholangiocarcinoma. These are the bile duct cancers arising from the ductal epithelial cells. They refer to the cancer arising in the intrahepatic 5 to 15% of the cases. Perihilar 60 to 70% of the cases are distal extrahepatic 25% of the bilateral. Represent approximately 3% of all gastrointestinal malignancies. This one, you can see here, intrahepatic, perihilar, and distal extrahepatic. So here you can see the incidence: intrahepatic 6%. Perihilar 67% and distal 27%. Now, bismuth correlative classifications have divided perihilar cholangiocarcinoma based on the pattern of involvement of hepatic ducts. Type 1 tumors occurring below the confluence of the left and right hepatic ducts. Type 2 tumors reaching the confluence. Type 3 A and B tumors occluding the common hepatic duct and either the right or left hepatic duct. While the type 4 tumors, they are multicentric, that involve the confluence and both the right or left hepatic duct. Now, this is an MCQ, the clad skin tumors. They occur at the bifurcation of the proper hepatic duct. So, they are called clad tumors. So, you can see in this figure here. This one, the type 1, 2, 3, 3A and 3B and type 4. The risk factors for the cholangiocarcinoma of the biliary, they are primary sclerosing cholangitis, which has 0.6 to 1.5% of incidence, annual incidence, and the polylocal cyst and Caroline disease has a 0.7% risk. 6.8% risk for the second 10 years and 14.3% thereafter. Then clonorchis and opisthorchis, then polylithiasis and hepatolithiasis, toxic exposure to thorotrast, Lynch syndrome 2 and multiple biliary papillomatosis. If we see the pathology of the hepatic biliary carcinoma, the 90% they are adenocarcinoma, they are slow growing, locally invasive, mucin producing, with a perineural subtract and metastatic is uncommon. Three subtypes of adenocarcinoma, they are sclerosing. Majority of the cholangiocarcinoma characterized by an intense desmoplastic reaction with early ductal invasion that leads to low receptivity rates. Then they may be nodular, constricting annular lesion of the bile duct. They may be papillary, present as a bulky mass occurring in the bile duct lumen, present early with biliary obstruction and with the highest disability. Clinically, we see the hepatobiliary carcinomas, there are a triad of symptoms: cholestasis with abdominal pain and weight loss. 66% patients have a pruritus, they have a clay-colored stool with dark urine. 90% develop jaundice with hepatomegaly, right upper quadrant mass. Curvature sign will be positive. Intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma typically presents without biliary obstruction. Lab results: elevation in the total bilirubin more than 10 mg per deciliter, direct bilirubin is the main hallmark of diagnosis. Alkaline phosphate is also raised 2 to 10-fold with 5 nucleotide A's when gamma glutamyl transaminase level initially normal, but with chronic biliary obstruction, liver dysfunction. The differential diagnosis: Cholelocolithiasis, bile duct strictures, sclerosing cholangitis, compression of the CVD. How we diagnose? There are certain tumor markers like serum markers, serum CEA more than 5.2 nanogram has a sensitivity of 68% with specificity of 82%. Middle CEA, CA19-9. If you see the radiographically, transabdominal ultrasonography may reveal the ductal dilatation, CT scan, MRCP or PET scan, go for that. Cholangiography, ERCP, preoperative drainage, endoscopic ultrasonography and PET scan. Staging, T1 tumors invade mucosa or muscle layer, T2 tumors invade periductal tissue, T3 tumor invade adjacent structure, N0 regional lymph node metastasis, N1 is metastasis in the cystic pericholecystocal and hilar lymph nodes, and N2 metastasis in the peripancreatic, periduodenal, periportal, celiac, superior mesenteric or posterior pancreatic or duodenal lymph nodes. M0 non-distant metastasis, M1 distant metastasis. This is a stage grouping. One stage is T1 N0 M0 T. Stage 2 T2 N0 M0, stage 3 T1 N1 M0 or T1 N2. Similarly, stage 4 T3 NEN M0 and stage 4 is NET, NEN and MO. Management. As for management is concerned, the very poor prognosis, the average 5-year survival is only 5 to 10%. The resectability rate is superior for the distant movement, actually. The resectivity rates for intrahepatic is 60%, perihilar 56% and distal 91%. So negative margin achieved only in 20 to 40% of the proximal tumor cases, 50% of the distal tumor cases. Current data is in evolution. Preoperative bilateral decompression we have to do, and preoperative portal vein embolization can go for that. Surgical procedure. Distal pancreatic duodenectomy, which has a 5-year survival rate of 15-20%, intrahepatic only carcinoma with hepatic resection, and 3-year survival rates of 22-60%. Perihilar cholangiocarcinoma have a 5-year survival rates 10-45%. So these are so far. Adjuvant radiation therapy we can give, adjuvant chemotherapy we can give, new adjuvant therapy we are going to give for that. Now, the last thing we will discuss about the gallbladder carcinoma. If you see the anatomy of the gallbladder, this is the thin walled green muscular sac, 10 cm almost long, tucked into the ventral fossa of the liver, stored and concentrates bile, expands bile into the cystic duct, and the sphincter of Oddi regulates the flow of bile back to the liver. So here you see also, as far as epidemiological study is concerned, while the gallbladder carcinoma, the incidence is 1 in 5,000, with the fifth most common GI malignancy. Women are affected more. High incidence in South America. 1% of the patient undergoing cholecystectomy for symptomatic gallstone has chances of gallbladder carcinoma. The risk factors for the gallbladder carcinoma are the gallstone, gallbladder polyps, chronic salmonella infection, abnormal pancreatic bile duct junction, porcelain gallbladder and advancing age. What does it present? Presentation is a non-specific. Diagnostic imaging from the sonography, CT, MRI and ultrasonography, we can go for that. Endoscopy. So this is the actually the progression to the CA takes up to 15 years. Adenocarcinomas, they are most common, 80 to 90% adenocarcinoma. This is your MCQ. Anaplastic 7%, squamous cell carcinoma 6%, lymphoma and sarcomas. So this is the staging of the gallbladder carcinoma. Intramucosal is stage 1. Extend to the muscularis is TNM stage 1. And Neumann stage 2 extends to the serosa, TNM stage 2. Transmural involvement is stage 3 and direct extension to the liver or Mets is stage 4. So it is a very simple for the carcinoma of the gallbladder. TNM staging is very simple. Intermucosal 0, extend to the muscularis 1, through the serosa 2, through the involvement of the cystic nodes 3 and 4 is the Mets of the liver. Only 10 to 30% resectable are at the time of diagnosis. If we we see for the gallbladder carcinoma, three presentations really are gallbladder carcinoma discovered during or after lap and open colic surgery for assumed benign disease, gallbladder carcinoma suspected after diagnostic evaluation, and gallbladder carcinoma at the advanced age at present. So the surgical options are simple colectomy, radical colectomy with anatomic liver section, and radical colectomy with people's procedure. So these are the cystic lymph nodes you can see. What to do during elective lap colic if GBA carcinoma is suspected intraoperatively? 0.4%, 0.5% are asymptomatic cases found to have GBCA in the lap colic. Convert to open resect ports, no place for laparoscopy. Management of T1A. The 5-year survival rate have improved for T1A disease following simple colectomy, that is a 75 to 100%. T1B, which involves the muscularis, is controversial. Then we have to do the simple or the radical colectomy. While this person will have 10-year survival for T1B tumors after simple colectomy was 87%. He noted about. Then incidental reductive gallbladder carcinoma in specimen re-exploration we should do with radical colectomy for T2 lesions are greater. So this is again the form, they have improved disease free survival from 20 to 60%, while the Alex Tabela, he showed improvement from 25% to 70% 5 years survival when they set this. High morbidity, locally advanced T3, T4 lesions have high morbidity and mortality rates 50% to 15%. People are reluctant to operate because of poor prognosis. But this Nakamura found extensive surgery first stage. 4 patients showed significant improvement in 5 years survival compared to the palliative or operative unresectability. So, management of locally unresectable disease involving the major vascular encasement, no debulking, chemoradiation therapy we should go, no identified impact on survival and remain investigation, systemic chemotherapy can be given. Contraindication to resection are mets to the liver, peritoneum, or encasement of major vessels. Direct involvement of the adjacent organ is not absolute.